1969, and the infamous Manson family murders took place. Public interest in the story skyrocketed, and needless to say, it never truly went away. Over the subsequent decades, endless documentaries and books on the topic have been released, one of which was Ed Sanders' The Family, released in 1971. In it, Sanders points to the existence of what he referred to as brutality or snuff movies, filmed by the Manson family during the police work. No such tapes were ever found or proven to be real, but the idea alone was able to spark the public's interest in the possible existence of such tapes, turning snuff into somewhat of an urban legend. This may have been where the term snuff originated, but even to this day, no one seems to be able to firmly agree on its definition, and consequently, whether or not they truly exist. To some, snuff films are simply defined as any film in which someone is snuffed out or murdered. To others, on-screen murder simply isn't enough, and to truly be considered a snuff film, it would have had to have been produced for profit and or entertainment, then promptly distributed through some kind of dark underground industry. No two people seem to give the same answer when asked exactly what defines a snuff film, aside from the murder on camera element of it. Because of this and how loosely the term is used, perhaps the debate of whether or not snuff films are indeed real has become rather pointless. Still, the debate goes on. Snuff being used as a gimmick time and time again in the media may have also given way to the public skepticism towards the topic. After all, the first claim of a so-called snuff film was laid out without evidence. Fast forward a bit, 5 years after the release of Ed Sanders' The Family. The year was 1976, and what was believed to be a real, genuine snuff film was finally being released. The movie, simply and boldly titled Snuff, was based on a Manson-like cult and was marketed as something that would finally validate the snuff legend. The film's creators even hired fake protesters to help sell its story, prompting actual protests from feminist activist groups and just about anyone else who was opposed to allowing such violence on the screen. For those seeking the truth about snuff, it seemed way too good to be true, and it was. Of course, the film that sparked so much outrage was revealed to be fake, but the publicity surrounding it already was enough to fuel the fire and leave the idea of the existence of snuff films uncomfortably sitting in the back of people's minds. This movie, although the most notable use of the snuff name to generate hype, was not the first to fool the public into believing that what they were seeing was actual death on screen, nor were they the last. It's absolutely impossible to talk about the spread of the snuff legend without bringing up films like the infamous 1980s pseudo-documentary Cannibal Holocaust. This film was so believable for its time, the director was nearly thrown in jail on murder charges. The actors, who many thought to have been killed, were contracted to not make any public appearances for at least a year after the film's release. This had the public so convinced that the actors were forced to appear in court to testify that they were in fact alive. Despite the human death and gore being faked, Cannibal Holocaust does feature animal snuff, which only added to its controversial image. Other notable films include the Faces of Death franchise, films mainly showing reenactments alongside actual footage of accidents, suicides, and war. Real death, sure, but not carried out for the sole purpose of being the movie. Serial killers are often one of the first things to come to mind when the topic of on-screen murder arises. After all, it's no secret that serial killers often take mementos to remember their crimes. Jeffrey Dahmer, for example, famously took grisly photographs of his victims' corpses and sexually suggestive poses. Harvey Blattman, known as the Lonely Hearts Killer, would photograph his victims bound and gagged before raping and murdering them. The list goes on and on. In short, serial killers like having something to look back on, helping them be heard. As technology developed and different types of crimes were widely available, serial killers in the latter half of the 20th century would surely be documenting their killings as they're taking place. This, of course, isn't necessarily true, as each case differs from the next. Still, this assumption has fueled long-lasting misinformation. In California in the early 1980s, serial killing duo Leonard Blake and Charles Ng took the lives of what's currently believed to be roughly 20-25 people. The pair were best known for their crimes against women. However, However, it wasn't uncommon for them to also murder the women's children and any other family members who got in the way. Leonard Lake, a longtime sexual deviant, fantasized about owning his very own sex slave, and even went on record saying so.
What I want is an off-the-shelf sex partner. I want to be able to use women whenever and however I want. And when I'm tired or bored or not interested, I simply want to put her away.
This wasn't all the pair recorded. The videos that came out of this string of heinous crimes was dubbed the Miranda Tapes. And while they didn't actually show any victims being killed on screen, they did feature brutal psychological torture. Despite this, rumors about the tapes spread, and to this day, people still mistakenly refer to them as the Miranda Snuff Films or the Miranda Murder Films. The same thing has happened to the infamous home videos shot by the husband and wife serial killing team Carlo Homolka and Paul Bernardo. The couple was responsible for the rape and murder of three teenage girls in Canada in the early 1990s, and it was possibly one of the most televised and controversial cases of that era. The tapes, created by the duo, played a huge role during the investigation, and soon became the focus of the public's attention. As awareness of the case spread, so did misinformation. Despite what telephoned versions of the story might say, the actual murders took place off-camera. Perhaps when it comes to pre-internet era serial killers and snuff, none other can compare to the case of Enzo Slivko. By 1961, Slivko was a 23-year-old married father of two living in Russia, and a well-respected figure in the community known for his award-winning short films and his position running a local boys' youth club. It was during this same year that Slivko would witness a horrific motor accident that would change his life forever. Walking the streets on an otherwise normal day, Slivko watched as a drunken motorcyclist fatally collided with a group of pedestrians. Amongst the victims was a young boy in his early teens, a Boy Scout in uniform. While most would find themselves horrified at the situation, Slivko instead began to find himself sexually aroused. He later went on to note the rush that took him on in that moment, describing the smell of gasoline and fire, and the appearance of the boy's blood as it trickled down the asphalt from his bank corpse. This was, according to Slivko, the first time he found himself attracted to young boys. Over the next two decades, Slivko would go on to abuse his position at the youth club in order to take advantage of 43 young boys. Slivko would manipulate them, claiming that he wanted them to participate in harmless experiments involving controlled hangings. In other cases, he'd tell the boys that they were to star in one of his upcoming short films. No matter the story he managed to feed to them, the truth, unfortunately, was much more sinister. Slivko would film the boys as they'd hang themselves, quickly slipping into unconsciousness. Once they were out cold, Slivko would bring them to the floor and position their bodies in sexually suggestive poses while masturbating and also molesting them. Out of the 43 boys tricked into doing this, only 36 would survive. The remaining 7, unfortunately, didn't. The footage shot by the killer shows the boys being strangled to death before they were dismembered and set on fire, allowing Slivko to relive the collision that took place on that fateful day in 1969. And of course, now he had it all on film to rewatch over and over. Despite the boys' deaths taking place on screen, given the vague definition of what makes a snuff film, many can still argue that this doesn't qualify as snuff because of the fact that Slivko never did or intended to sell or profit off of his creations. Again, the semantics battle over snuff films leaves us running in circles and is ultimately pointless, especially in the present day, where we know for a fact that we can watch actual recorded murders take place online with the click of a button. The motivations behind these videos will vary, but the undeniable truth is that they do exist, especially considering the current state of technology, where sharing information is instant, and most people carry a camera right in their pockets. Needless to say, the phenomenon of on-screen murder has grown with the times, and has drastically evolved with the introduction of the internet. In part 2 of this video coming next week Wednesday, we'll discuss death and killing on camera in the next video, given the existence of shock waves, online streaming, and the deep web. With that being said, thank you so